another letter has arrived for you, Miss March.
Mrs. Kirk, the mutton you ordered is on the table. Thank you, Professor. Christopher Columbus, another publisher, another rejection?
I do not know, Miss March. I don't read your letters, but they keep coming and I keep giving them to you, of course.
Dear Miss March, I read your story. Well, he's read it. Unfortunately, I found your tale tasteless and vulgar, not at all suitable for my readers. My advice to you...
My advice to you is to return home and have... Oh! Babies! Sincerely yours, F. Putnam.
22 rejections since I've been in New York. They all say the same thing. Give up! Go home!
F. Putnam is an idiot, and his words are stupid.
F. Putnam is one of the most powerful publishers in the city.
You mustn't give up faith, Miss Marsh. There is someone in this city that will enjoy your stories. I'm sure of it.
Professor?
Yes?
Is there any chance I could read one of my stories to you? I would so appreciate your opinion.
Yes, of course.
Actually, it's one of my best. It's a mean and stormy night. The moors are bleak and bloody. Thunder claps, lightning strikes. The fair Clarissa, her clothes in disarray, races across the wide coastal heath. Now she stops. Now she runs. Will she escape? Will she be caught? With bold determination, the villainous aristocrat, Braxton Prendergast, lurches for her. There's no escape. She's but a child, and yet she turns to fight with eyes ablaze. This noble girl meets his gaze unafraid. She will not be defiled.
Keep away from me, you wretch!
I cannot keep away. Your beauty draws me. Your passion ignites me. I've got to have you.
I defy you.
Got to hold you.
Let me buy you.
Come close.
Don't come too close.
Come close.
Don't come too close.
So close, so close to me. I'll have her and the mother too.
And at that moment, Rodrigo appears in magnificent splendor.
Unhand that twin villain. Who are you?
I am your destiny, your bitterest foe. I come to avenge your crimes of 10 years ago. You left me cold, alone and forgotten. Now I'm back to settle the score.
Miss March? What is it that you're writing here?
Blood and guts stuff. It's all the rage. The magazines and periodicals are full of it.
Violence and seduction on every page?
Read history. Read Shakespeare. Read the newspapers.
It's getting late. Perhaps we must pursue this some other time.
No, Professor. I want to know what you think.
Blood and guts stuff, yes. What you think the world wants to hear. Miss March, if I've learned nothing else about you in your time here, it's that you are unique, something you should try not to forget. I think that you could do a little better.
Better?
Yes.
And who are you anyway, an aging German professor close to 50?
I'm 34.
34?
Yes.
Really? Well, you look a lot older.
Well, I worry a lot.
And just what do you worry about?
How to avoid a conversation such as this. I'm going to go to dinner. Miss March. Since you have come here, 6 weeks now, is it, you rant, and you rout, and you shriek. I am a serene and peaceful man.
You're aloof. You're arrogant.
Arrogance. Miss March, I have spoken my piece as you have said yours. And obviously, it was not appreciated on either side.
Obviously. My stories were a great success in Concord. Ever
Sisters. Forever!
Forever!
Go, let's rehearse!
wretch, you will have me or no one! No one!
Perfect Douglas fir. I should have you arrested.
I'll make it up to you, sir.
With what?
I'll plant 6 more.
12.
And I'll chop your firewood for a few days.
Wait, and I hope such an incident never happens again. Ah, you ruined my day.
He loves his trees. I'm Theodore Lawrence III. Everyone calls me Lori. I've come to live here. In Concord, I play the piccolo, I can sleep standing up, and I won a medal at school for holding my breath for maybe 3 minutes before passing out. I think that was terrifically daring of you, chopping down grandfather's tree. Well, goodbye.
Theodore wants the third. Would you mind bringing this tree to the Hummels, Joe?
I don't mind at all.
He doesn't mind.
Just point me in the direction.
They live half a mile down the road, the red house with the broken shingles.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas! Don't think before you act on every whim. I just wanted us to have a great Christmas, Marmy.
A letter's come from Father.
Christopher Columbus. Read the letter, Marmy.
My dear wife, the war goes on and on. The end seems nowhere in sight. The days are difficult and long, but I am well.
He's well.
Still, it's very lonely away from my dear ones, especially lonely as Christmas is approaching. Each night in my tent, I think of my precious girls.
He thinks of us.
Give them all my love. Give them a sweet kiss. Tell them to be good girls, faithful and hardworking, to conquer that which is disagreeable in them, so that when I return, I'll be fonder and prouder than ever of my little women. Why are we looking so glum?
We have an operatic tragedy to perform or not?
We do!
Then we have work to do. There are costumes to complete, and we'll need an oleo curtain for you to paint.
Will you perform something, Marmy?
Do, Marmy.
I'll write something for you, with passion and daring.
Yes. Yes, I will. We'll make this the best Christmas ever. We, Mark Truman, are invincible. Come, let's get to work.
I'll get my paints. I'll find a costume for Marmy.
I'll plan the handbill.
I still don't know why we couldn't have kept the tree.
Take my fears away. Can I manage for
Begins with me at 9. You've missed reading to me, and you still haven't prepared the latch on the cellar door.
I got delayed finding you this beautiful banana.
A half-eaten banana. Don't trifle with me, Josephine. You were dawdling.
I was not dawdling. I was writing a story.
You are what happens to a girl when she has no father.
I have a father.
Never here when you need him. And now my own nephew has the audacity to be an army chaplain when he can't even support his own family. Josephine, you are on the verge of womanhood.
Christopher Columbus.
Oh, and just look at you. You go about writing senseless stories, constantly trying to save the world, and you can't even save yourself.
I don't need saving.
There are many pitfalls a girl can fall into, and Josephine, you are heading straight towards all of them. I want to see you shine. Even if you aren't rich, you can at least marry well.
I'll never marry.
All girls marry, you'll marry.
I'm not all girls.
With a good marriage, you can have power. You can take your place in society.
I don't give two figs about society.
Oh, well, then there is no point in us having this conversation. It is clear to me that I could never take you to Europe.
Take me to Europe? And March, do you know how important it is for a writer to travel? It's been my dream.
We earn our dreams in this world, Josephine. It is foolish of me to think that you could ever change your ways.
I could try.
You could never bend your will. You could never follow through. You could never bite your tongue, though your tongue may split in two. If you want to live your dreams, these are things you have to do. How could you change? You can't, not you.
I could change if I wanted to.
Practice self-control. Could you possibly be shy? Could you wear a corset tight in the heat of mid-July? These are rules you must obey. Everyone which you defy, you'll never change. You won't, that's why. Yet somewhere deep within my heart, I do believe you could captivate the world. If you could change, there is so much you could achieve. In time you could succeed and travel very far indeed. You could be beguiling, charming me, someone well-mannered, a model of grace. Learn the art of smiling.
That could be hard,
It isn't very hard for someone full of dreams like you. If you work, you'll find there's nothing you can't do.
So if I change, we'll go to Paris.
Change completely or don't waste my time.
If I change, we'll stop in Antwerp.
Gracious living will make you sublime.
If I change, you'll take me to Zurich.
Every city from Dublin to Cork.
Surely with your guidance, I could learn to use from a minerals with your arms. I could keep you barley.
For a chance to see the world, learn the art of smiling.
I could button up my mind and keep my thoughts perfumed and cold. Yes, I surely think I could.
If you could, that would be good.
There's nothing that I would suffer to see the world.
I could do it if I try. I could do it by sheer will. All you have to do is work to acquire any skill. There are things a girl must do if she has dreams she must fulfill. Change how you walk, change how you talk, change how you think, it's how you love.
I'd rather hold my tongue than what it takes to travel far.
I'm not built for gowns.
You look very alluring.
I think the word is alarming, Marley. Meg, she's the beauty. She'll be the most sought-after girl at the ball.
She doesn't want to go.
Meg!
What will I do when someone asks me to dance?
Just smile and say,
I'd be delighted. Delighted.
Then offer him your hand.
Delighted. Delighted. Now let him take command.
I'm hardly delighted.
You're dancing like a candle.
No, I cannot dance tonight.
I'd be delighted.
Then you go.
The music is entrancing. Exotic, hypnotic, the sound of men romancing.
Delighted.
Delighted. And some of them are glancing. People everywhere. Elegance to spare.
How can I be sure they'll like me when I'm there?
I can see you dancing all night.
Thank you.
invited, provided success has been decided. My letter, which you like to do.
I have. These are the March girls I've been telling you about. The ones from across the way. This is Meg, right?
Yes.
And this is Joe. She cuts our firewood on occasion. This is Mr. Burke. He's a scholar from Boston.
I'm Lori's tutor. Come, Lori.
Sir, You've taken my dance card.
Your dance card? Oh, is this yours? Sorry. So you're Margaret March.
Yes, I am.
It's a splendid party, isn't it?
Yes, it's quite lovely. So you're from Boston?
Actually, Maine.
I've never been to Maine.
You should go. It's a beautiful country. Very, primitive.
I like primitive.
Really?
Mr. Brooke is a romantic.
Is that true?
Well, no. I read Keyes and Shelley. I mean, she's a Kelly.
So do I.
You read Keyes and Shelley?
All the time.
Christopher Columbus.
This March.
Meg, we were just about to join the ladies in the parlor.
I would be delighted, Mr. Brooke.
This is Joe. Did you see that? He just... What is it with you and that smile?
You make me beam.
Well, you look ridiculous.
You're looking very fetching tonight.
Fetching? Real.
So, tell me, when you're not attending balls, what do you do?
I write blood and guts stuff. I make extraordinary plans. I'm going to Europe. I'm going to meet famous writers and revolutionaries. So what about you? What do you do? Marmy says you're all alone in the world, no mother or father. It must be hard for you.
It's not hard. I've got a cranky old grandfather. And I've got a cat. And I've got...
What?
Well, I was hoping to say you.
You don't have me!
I know I have no right. Sometimes at night I watch from that attic, pacing back and forth like a maniac. I've never met a girl like you, anyone at all like you. This is very nice, such a lovely party. The music sounds so thrilling. It makes a person feel like dancing. I'm very good. I won a medal at school dancing.
I don't dance. Besides, I've got a patch on the back of my dress.
A patch? Let me see.
No!
I like it. That patch is on a whole new fashion. Dance with me tonight, and I guarantee you by next spring, every girl in Concord will be wearing a patch in her dress. We could do 100 things, do anything you please. We could fly with golden wings across the seven seas. I bet we'll get a camel through a needle if you take a chance on me.
You are a lunatic.
I could catch 1,000 stars and set them on a grid. We could leave from here to Mars and make the planet spin. If you will do all things you have dreamed of, come on, take a chance on me. Such friends, friends are never lonely. All I know is books, books are solitary. I see you every day. How you live in your own way. You box?
You ready?
I should warn you, I want a medal for boxing at school.
Is that how you win medals?
You cheat. You could live on dreams, if we dare, you win. We could go to such extremes. There's so much we could share. Let us circle the world in all we've ever done. And we'll live in our own way. And I'll see you every day. We'll be the best of.
of France. Let me take a chance on me. Try me?
I challenge you to a skating race tomorrow at the pond. Come on!
We'll circle the world and all we've ever dreamed of. Cause we'll take a chance. Yes, we'll take a chance. Finally take a chance.
March, John Brooke, Lori's tutor. We were dancing and the ankle maybe sprained. Thank you. Good night.
Good night.
The night began very strangely and ended magnificently. Well, good night.
Good night. Can you walk on it?
There's nothing, Marmee.
Tell us about the ball. Marmee, I did all of these ladylike things that went unnoticed, except by Mr. Lawrence's grandson. Poor Meg, no one even asked her to dance except that pompous Mr. Brooke.
He danced divinely. I had a wonderful time. In fact, the best time of my life. I may have left here a girl, but I came home a woman.
A woman? Well, what are you talking about, Meg?
Marmee, it's just Meg being silly.
Come, girls, off to bed now. It's been a long day for all of us.
Oh, Beth, darling, I brought something for you. A truffle.
Thank you, Joe.
Amy.
Good night, Marmee.
I'm sorry for the things I said, Joe.
And for you, Miss March, a petite four in there somewhere. It's a little squished, but it should be still edible.
Coming, Joe?
Oh, I'm just gonna put the finishing touches to my story, Marmee.
Don't be too late. See that the fire is out.
I want something that's mine! And I'll take my fan back!
so sorry. It's not your fault. Though you did give birth to her.
Can't you see she wants to be like you? She wants to have what you have. She's just a child, Joe.
She is not a child. She is a demon in a child's body.
If I could bring back your story, I would.
My writing is everything to me, Marmee. It's my dream. It's my future. It's who I am.
The passion is still in you. Believe me, Joe.
I'll never forgive her.
You're not wrong, Joe, to feel anger. But if you build a wall between you and Amy, one person you may end up hurting is yourself. I couldn't bear that. Try and get some sleep.
I can't sleep. I won't. I will never fall asleep again. Not for decades, no, not even then. My life was in these stories. How could she be so cruel? How can so much be lost so easily? I wrote my heart out. It does not seem fair. I'll rage until I'm weathered. I'll grow cold and bitter. Carla, the madwoman in the attic, a spinster, rejected by the world, changed her appearance. I like this. She attached golden braids to her hair.
Joe, come skate with me. The ice is frozen off. The pot is magnificent. Joe, come.
I can't, Lori. I'm finishing a story.
Finish it later.
All right. I'll give you 2 minutes head start.
2 minutes?
And still beat you.
Piano sounds terrible.
Needs a tuning, sir.
Where's my grandson, Lord? The boy's missed 6 lessons, fallen behind in all of this work. I've strictly forbidden him to associate with this family.
Why, sir?
Because a man needs an iron will if he's to succeed in this world, and this family will only soften him. Which one of the dreadful little March girls are you?
I'm dreadful, Beth.
Oh, yes. Lori said you're the one who wants to play my priceless piano. It's out of the question. The piano belonged to my daughter, Lori's mother. It's been locked since she's passed away, and that's how I shall stay. Are you afraid of me?
A little.
Why?
It might have something to do with your face. It's very hard.
I cannot help my heart fits. Now, go on. Continue what you're playing. Come on, huh? Have a daughter. You're going to play or not?
If you say, come with me off to Massachusetts, then to Massachusetts we will go.
China, then we'll dine a while on cream soucettes.
Go on.
We will build model boats off in Massachusetts. They're in Massachusetts by the bay. Put them together and wait until the glue sets.
What's the matter now?
I don't remember the rest, sir.
While we wait, we'll polka for the folk along the parapets.
Off
to Massachusetts.
Yes, we're off
to where the shops are sweet.
We will play minuets off in Massachusetts, Boston, Massachusetts, Beacon Street.
If you say off to Massachusetts, then to Massachusetts we will go. We will buy this book, maybe even 2 cents. By the finest china, then we'll dine a while on crepes and suzettes.
Off
to Massachusetts.
Yes, we're off
to where the shops are sweet.
We will
have no regrets off in Massachusetts. Boston, Massachusetts, we.
Boston, Massachusetts, we.
Boston, Massachusetts, we repeat. Well, goodbye.
Goodbye.
Come visit me tomorrow. I'll find the key to that old piano. We'll see if there's some music left in it. Will you come?
Yes.
And when you see my grandson, tell him I wish to see him at once.
Oh, Maddie!
What is it, Dad?
Mr. Lawrence was here. He invited me to come to his house and play his piano.
Oh, Dad!
He's really not as horrible as we imagined.
Amy!
What happened? She fell through the ice.
She was skating by the bridge and the ice suddenly gave way.
She's careless. She's rash. She just wanted to be with you here.
I was skating so beautifully.
You don't think? Everyone knows the ice by the bridge is dangerous.
Well, you didn't want me skating by you. I love your stories, Joe. I tried to write one myself to make up for what I did. I couldn't think of anything to say. So I drew you a picture instead of you and your beautiful hair
and my big mouth.
And you just ignored it.
You skated recklessly. If it hadn't been for Lori, you could have been killed.
Maybe it would have been better if I had.
You must never talk like that. The moment the ice broke through, the only thing I thought of was I could have lost you.
Then go on, Joe. Forgive her.
See how much she's changed.
See her sweet side. Stop, everyone! I was devastated when you burned my story. I didn't understand how anyone could do such a thing. But promise me you'll never think of me as an enemy, but as a sister who loves you.
I promise, Joe. March sisters forever.
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 Lori. You saved Amy and made this day possible. I want to declare before everyone, before the world, that on this day of forgiveness and joy, that you, Theodore Lawrence III, who has valiantly lost all contests to me, I declare you our brother, the brother we never had. Swear to us your greatest oath of loyalty, an oath as dazzling as your charms.
I swear I'll follow you like royalty.
Come wear our royal coat of arms.
From now on we are joined, and we shall not be parted. From this day on it's all for one, and one for all for life.
And we'll live like musketeers.
Together we'll prevail.
Be far forever from now on.
Now each of us must swear for all eternity. Our bond shall never be undone.
Nothing shall sever this fraternity. We'll always live and die as one. From now on, we
We are joined to have peace on not important. For the sin on his love, one hand on for all the life.
Together we will fight.
Your battles will be mine.
We'll be forever, forever from now on.
Speech!
Speech!
On this wonderful day.
I'll check in on the girls every day. I'll just stick
with this. Mr. Roberts.
Oh, good morning.
Good morning, Mr. Roberts. Marnie, I made you a basket of food. Thank you, Beth.
Amy's almost ready. She's packing up half the house.
Where's Joe? I sent her to it just hours ago. She should be back by now. I'll go look for her.
Here's the shawl Father loves so much.
Marnie! Please don't make me go to Aunt March's house while you're in Washington. It scares me there. Everything's so old in it. Oh, I drew this picture of you with apple blossoms in your hair. It's for Father. Is he going to die?
Oh, no, Amy. I'll see to it that he recovers. Now go and get the rest of your things.
Sorry I'm late, Marmy, but I did get the money, though.
Oh, thank you, Joe. I know how difficult it is for you to ask Aunt March for...
I didn't. I couldn't, so I went to the town common and tried to sell my stories, and when that didn't work, I sold my hair.
Oh, my.
You're bald.
I am not bald. Your hair was your best feature.
That's beautiful.
Now Marmy will have enough money to get her safely to Washington and stay with Father for as long as he needs. Here. $27.25. I threw in a few coins that I'd stashed away.
Joe, you shouldn't have done this. I'm so disappointed. Proud. It was a very courageous thing to do. Thank you, Joe.
We're all ready, Mrs. March. Joe?
Oh.
you look different.
Well, Miss March, we must hurry if we want to make it to the station.
By next spring, I guarantee you that every girl in Concord will be wearing her hair.
More. Let me meet my girls. We've never been parted before. I feel so awful.
Amy.
I'll take care of everything, Marmy. My dear Margaret, make sure your husband recovers.
Yes, Aunt March. Thank you for taking Amy. Amy, tell Aunt March how excited you are.
I'm so excited to live with you while Marmy's in Washington, Aunt Mark.
No glum faces and no tears. I'll be back as soon as possible. How did you all grow up so fast? Goodbye, Aunt March. Oh, and you'll tell Father how much I miss him and I love him and...
Josephine. Josephine, what have you done?
I sold my hair so that Mommy could get to Washington.
You did what? I've told you if you need money, come to me.
I wanted to earn my own money.
Cutting one's hair and selling it like a beggar is not an option for a lady. You look like a shorn sheep. Have you forgotten our contract?
I could never forget it. Traveling, seeing Europe, it's my dream, Aunt March.
Well, it's clear that you don't hold up your part of the bargain. Why should I hold up mine?
I've tried to hold up my end of the bargain. I went to a ball with Meg. I read books on etiquette and I held my tongue in several situations where I wanted to cry out. I have a fire in me, Aunt March.
Well, let's see how far this fire takes you in life. Let's see what doors this fire will open. Let's see what society thinks of your fire.
To hell with society!
Josephine.
No, we shouldn't live for society. We should live for what's inside of us. To fulfill our dreams, expand our minds, engage in passionate
changes. That's enough. You think you know everything, but yet you know nothing. And as for Europe, oh, you can forget about Europe. It is clear to me that Europe is meant for someone with a little more understanding of its rewards.
Aunt March, please.
The subject is closed.
The subject is not closed, and if it is, I open it up again. I'll get to Europe. I'll get to Europe if I have to swim there. Hello, John.
I like your haircut, Joe.
And it will grow back.
And just who is this man?
He's always tutor and friend.
Well, tell your friend. His visit should be brief. Amy, collect your things. I'll be waiting for you in the carriage. I have plans for you.
Yes, ma'am.
John, what have you done?
I've enlisted. I couldn't stand by any longer. Your own father's in an army hospital in Washington. I have friends that will never return.
When do you leave?
Tonight. Meg, Martin, I'm not a rich man. And I'm not particularly handsome.
You're very handsome, John.
Really? You think so? I'm not the wisest man in the world.
You're very wise.
Thank you. Meg. If you could find it in your heart, if you would love me as I love you, if only you cared, we were apart, then I will be rich, I will be wise, I will be more than I am. If you will wait while I am gone, if you imagine me here with you, if only you care, if I carry on, then I will be strong.
What is too long?
I could be brave. I could be more. More than I am. If you will say you love me enough to marry me, I will come home and love you with all of my life. Then I will be more than I am. Say yes, make me more than I am.
Today,
this moment on, though we'll be apart.
It's settled. We'll all go to Europe. Why shouldn't we go? We are young and capable of taking care of ourselves. It's time we looked ahead. We'll start saving our pennies and I'll get a real job.
Joe.
I planned out our itinerary. We'll go to Spain first, Madrid, then to Rome. See the Vatican, have an audience with the Pope. It's a wonderful idea, isn't it?
Joe, I'm engaged. Sean proposed, and I accepted.
Engaged? Meg's engaged? That's so romantic. Have a big wedding. Aunt March says they're very fashionable.
Aunt March is waiting for you. I'll come see you later.
Bye, everybody. What about our promise to remain together?
We made that a long time ago. I changed. Joe, you've changed.
I haven't changed. I would never make a promise one day and break it the next. Our word is everything, Meg.
I love him.
So you love him. I'm talking about us here. Our future as a family is at stake. You can't turn your back on us.
I'm not turning my back on you.
I told you, I'm going to become a famous writer.
I know.
And I'll give you all you've ever dreamed of. If she loves him, Joe.
I do, with all my heart and soul.
I've lost Meg.
You haven't lost Meg.
I've lost my trip to Europe.
You'll find your winning someday, Joe. I know you will.
You can make the clouds disappear. It's you who makes the clouds disappear.
Come, walk with me. Tell me all about your adventures tonight.
Well, I sold my hair. And before that, I tried to sell my stories in the town common, shouting, Joe March is here! And I recited it. Hold on. And then...
best friend Theodore Lawrence III.
And her fingers clutched with rage as she went out into the wretched night. Flory, 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 it's so good to see you. You haven't been here in weeks.
No, I was in Boston. I have dreadful news.
What news?
Well, with the war ended, grandfather's insisted I get on with my life. He's enrolled me in school.
That's wonderful news.
What's wonderful about it? You mean the best friend I've ever had?
I can't imagine Concord without you. Not seeing your silly grin every day.
I don't want to go.
College? I'd go in a minute. I'd study everything.
What do you need of college? You're going to be a famous writer, Joe.
Famous?
Can I tell you something?
Tell me something.
Ever since the first day I met you, Joe, do you remember that day?
Of course.
The day you chopped out grandfather's terrace tree, I knew then that we would be magnificent together.
We are magnificent together.
My dear Joe, for weeks now, this whole year actually, I've wanted to...
What was that?
A kiss.
I know it was a kiss.
It was my first kiss. I thought about it for a long time.
could live a million dreams, but only if we dare. We could go to such extremes, there's so much we could share.
What's gotten into you?
Look here, I took apart my inheritance. Ring.
What are you talking about, Laurie?
I want to marry you, Joe.
Marry me? Stop this, Laurie. It's not funny.
I practice saying the words over and over. Marry me. Marry me, Joe.
No. No. Find someone else. Find some accomplished girl.
I don't want an accomplished girl. I want you.
Well, you can't have me.
If at least say you'll think about it.
There's nothing to think about. I'll never marry.
You don't mean that.
I do.
You'll marry? You'll marry. Just not me. That's what you're really saying? You'll find someone?
I won't. Go away. I thought you understood me.
You knew all along how I felt. Everyone knew.
You knew all along who I am. What I want. I bared my soul to you, Laurie.
So?
Go, please. Just... who is he who is marrying me? With his ring, who is marrying me? The nerve, the gall. This is not what was meant to be. How could he ruin it all with those two words? I thought I knew him, thought that he knew me. When did it change? What did I miss? A kiss, when I thought all along that we were meant to forge frontiers. How could I be so wrong? And I need my sisters here. If I can't share my dreams, what were they for? I thought our promise meant that we would never change and never part. I thought together we'd amaze the world. How can I live my dreams or even start when everything has come apart? I thought home was all I'd ever want. My attic, all I'd ever need. Now nothing feels the way it was before. And I don't know how to proceed. I only am meant for something more. I've got to know if I can be astonishing. There's a life that I am meant to lead. A life like nothing I have known. I can feel it. And it's far from here. I've got to find it on my own. Even now I feel its heat upon my skin. A life of passion that pulls me from within. A life that I am making to begin. There must be somewhere I can be unexpected and unknown. I'll find my life in my own way today. Here I go, and there's
my time and place, I will be fearless, surrendering modesty and grace. I will not disappear without a trace. I'll shout and start a riot. Be anything but quiet. Christopher Columbus, I'll be astonishing.
Friends, we are simply acquaintances.
I see. Helga!
Is that my coat?
Oh, look whose nose is out of the book. If you're going to leave it out, I'm going to wash it. Someone's got to do the work around here.
You and the others in this household seem to be under the impression that me and Miss March have a sort of kinship. We do not. We've simply gone places together.
The theater?
Yes, yes, I took her to see Hamlet.
Pathetic tale it is.
Yeah, yes, very pathetic, and I've given her 3 German lessons.
3? That many,
Yes, and I've taken her to the park to hear the speakers, and I've taken her to lectures, and in any case, Miss March hardly seems to even know I exist. She is preoccupied. She rushes past me like the wind.
Christopher Columbus! Mrs. Kirk, have you seen the professor?
Behind you, darling.
Ah, guten Tag.
Guten Tag, Miss March. The word is Guten Tag. Guten Tag means good day.
I know what it means, just when you taught it to me, you said Guten Tag.
I would never say Guten Tag.
Well, I'm sure you did.
Well, I'm sure I didn't.
All right. Guten Tag. And it is a wonderful Guten Tag, a marvelous Guten Tag. And I have some amazing news. I came to New York on a dream. I knew it might take me a while, but all I've been hearing since I arrived is we were right there on the pile. So today I woke up and decided it's time. Time to achieve, time to ride, time to ride.
Miss March, tell us what happened.
Sometimes when you dream, your dream is just a guess. Sometimes when you work hard, you don't know if you'll ever find success. So I grabbed a story to sell, and got ready to raise hell. Then I marched out the door and headed right for the weekly volcano plus.
Henry Dashwood, now he is a man of taste.
Dashwood was a fiend. He sneered at my distress. Tossed my story high a stack. I was determined I would progress. I said, sir, I'll wait while you read. But alas, he disagreed. So I
jumped on a chair and ran it right there at the wicked volcano crest.
You did what?
Oh, keep away from me, you wretch!
I cannot keep away. Your beauty draws me. Your passion ignites me.
Oh, it's the horror in it, the bloodbath.
That's the one. But I took the one that you inside and I embellished. I made it better. The thunder claps, lightning strikes.
I've got to have you.
I can find you.
I will take you.
Rodrigo appears in magnificent splendor.
Who are you?
I am your destiny, your bitterest foe. I've come to avenge your crimes of 10 years ago.
Where's
the forest run? You must take the dark path.
You've made a way through there. She'll never escape me.
Go now.
I'm gone.
Hurry.
Dashwood was aghast, but I could not care less. Words I spoke ignited air. I felt like a publishing lioness. That's when Dashwood started to shout, and I thought he'd throw me out. But then I persevered, and a forest appeared at the windy volcano press. The forest is dark and scary. Clarissa enters, trembling, fearful of what fate awaits her. She comes to a fork in the road and stops. Which way do I go? A hand appears.
I can help you choose, but you must make a sacrifice. Give me something, dear. Those combs are not.
Race from the forest, race.
face to the moors where she cried out, I have returned, Braxton! I will free the moors of your tyranny! Fight me!
Always knew you'd come back to me! They always do!
Larissa! Rest! She parries! She backs up Braxton and pins him against a tree! She leaps up onto a craggy rock, her sword swishing and swooshing! Never has she been more determined in her life! She is on fire! Pity she hadn't taken dueling lessons. Then, out of nowhere, who should appear but the long forgotten Rodrigo!
I've waited a lifetime to destroy you.
Who are you?
I'm your worst nightmare, Braxton. I am her sister.
And then Dashwood got on his knees, crying, sell this to me, please.
Miss March!
And he ordered for more. Now I'm writing for the weekly Volcano. I should like that very much. Oh, I almost forgot. In all of the excitement, a telegram came for you, Miss March. More good news, I suspect.
Open it, Miss March. Open it.
I will. Today, I could start a revolution. I could... What is it, Miss March?
Is it not good news?
Dear God, no. My sister Beth has contracted scarlet fever. She's gravely ill. I must go to her immediately. I'm so sorry, dear. For you and for your family.
Is there anything we can do?
No. Thank you. Mrs. Kirk, tell your girls. They'll be fine. Tell them to keep reading. I will. Thank you both for everything.
Miss March, I should like to accompany you.
Accompany me?
Yes, yes, you should not travel alone.
I traveled here alone. I shall be fine, but thank you, Professor.
Yes, yes. And Miss March, you will be back, yes?
Of course I will.
And Miss March, one last, Phil Gluck.
Yes. I will need good luck.
Seems your simple acquaintance is leaving you, Professor.
All right, Mr. Felix, time to get up. Get off the sofa. You live here, you're helping with the chores.
Thank you.
heavy piece of wood, isn't it?
Light as a feather, sir.
And Joe knows nothing about it?
Joe has seen to everything.
A little more. There.
Whew.
That's it.
Yes.
The last is found out.
It's a beauty, sir. I'll let Joe know.
John, wait. The flowers.
Magnificent. But, Mr. Lawrence, you shouldn't have.
But I did. And enough said on the matter.
Joe!
She's ready.
It's in place.
Meg! Where are you taking me?
You'll see.
Is it Amy? Is she back? It's not Amy. She's not back.
Then what is it?
Patience. There. Mr. Lawrence.
Over here.
My piano.
No, Beth. Yours.
Mine? Marmy, no.
There was no arguing with him.
But why, sir?
Because it kept calling. Where's the dreadful little marsh girl? It missed you.
Go sit at it, Beth. Thank you, Mr. Lawrence. I'll treasure it. Play something for us, Beth. It sounds good.
Oh, Joe, I forgot to tell you. I received a letter from Lori this morning. He had been in New York and...
Lori was in New York?
Didn't he come visit you?
No.
Oh, I'm sorry. But he was in such a bad way, moping about for weeks. I insisted he do some work for me, then go to Europe and enjoy himself. And guess who we met up with in Florence?
Who?
Amy and your Aunt March. Miss March, may I join you?
With the honor, sir.
If you say come with me off to Massachusetts, then to Massachusetts we will go.
We will buy dishes there, maybe even two sets.
Buy the finest china, then we'll dine a while in grapes and zest.
New York. I miss New York.
Off to Massachusetts, yes, we're off. So when the shops are sweet, we will have no regrets off to Massachusetts.
Dear Professor Bayer, I have been wanting to write you. So much is happening here. My sister Meg is having a baby. My sister Beth is very frail. But I know I have it in me to make her better. I've decided to take her and my mother to Cape Cod, to Falmouth for a few days. Given all that is happening here, I don't know when I can return to New York. I miss it. I miss those volatile exchanges we had. I miss our walks in the park to hear the
speakers shout how they would change the world. And I, too, would like to change the world. Yes, of course. And how are you, sir? She asks how I am, and so how am I? My days are the usual days. I wake up, I go out. Time goes by. My days are exactly the days I've lived since arriving here. In fact, I am as amazed how this comforts me here by here. I work and I eat, life is muffins and jam. The house is nice and quiet now. That is how I am. 5 years in these rooms, reading Hegel and Kant. My mind is devoted to thoughts on the meaning of life. What more could I want? So why is it lately I find I'm uneasy all through the night? And why even now does my skin feel explosive as dynamite? Why does my heart pound like a battering ram? How can she ask me how I am? How I am is fine. Miss March, there is nothing dramatic or new to report. This will be short. morning and evening I live in my usual way. And on the day you return, you will see for yourself. Tell me, Miss March, are you happy so far? From the clang and the beat of our turbulent street, quite often I think of our days in New York. Though of course since you went, I have been quite content. I wake in the morning and all that I hear is the absence of sound. Yes, my peace is disturbed, but the ruckus is me as my thoughts run aground. I wanted a life by myself in these rooms, but now around me another like rooms who has to be coming to go and to leave me like that. And now she expects me to send her a note with words that I spoke that would stick in my throat, who has to change how I live, how I think, how I am. Lessons I wait, time goes by. Yet late you'll find there's pleasure in having a city too. And some days I go to the park and I sit there all afternoon. Some evenings I swear I could hear a door slam. The house is far too quiet now. That is how I am.
Promise me, Beth, whatever's got a hold of you, you'll continue to fight it.
Look back, look what I made for you. A kite. I put all the colors of the rainbow just for my sister. That's the most beautiful kite I've ever seen.
I shall leave you too.
Oh, no, Marnie.
I'll go write a letter to Father and tell him how beautiful the cape is this time of year. I love you.
This is a dream come true, Beth. Come. Sit with me and help me put this cape together. So, tell me about New York.
It's a circus.
A circus?
Dancing camels, waltzing horses. Sometimes you see them right out in the street.
And theaters, Beth, everywhere.
And the women, are they shameless? Some of them, anyway.
I'm going to take you there.
To New York?
And we'll dine in the finest restaurants. And see Shakespeare and ride the omnibus and mingle with unsavory characters.
Joe, I have something for you. Marnie says this shell is over 1,000 years old, and I believe once it had an amazing life. If you put it up to your ear, it talks to you.
What does it say?
It says we grow up too fast. You're a woman of the world now, Joe. I'm so proud of you.
When you were first born, not an hour old, I told Marnie,
the best is mine.
Everyone has someone special in the world, Beth, and I have you. My sweet Beth, give me a task to do.
Let's pretend we're riding on a kite. Let's imagine.
white as paper will soar, will be wound up high above the sand. Feel the wind, the world at our command. Let's enjoy the view and never land, floating far from the shore. Clouds moving fast and free, the sun on a silver sea, a sky that's bright and blue. Some things will never end, the thrill of our magic ride, the love that I feel inside.
Thank you.
everybody! Everybody, I'm home!
Oh, just look at this house.
Joe, Marmy!
We've left it in shambles, and it's still in shambles.
Meg! Did you see the look I gave the coachman, Aunt March? His impertinence, he caught every bump in the road.
One should always respect the coachman. You must respect those who have the reins until you wrench the reins from them.
Yes, Aunt March. Joe Marmy!
And Amy, remember, you are a lady now.
Yes, a lady. Meg! When did this house get so small?
As we grow grand, Amy, the world around us often diminishes in size. I've seen people disappear before my very eyes.
You're such a dear, Aunt March. Thank you for everything.
Well, I'll go see to that wretched coachman.
Remember, Aunt March, respect those who have the reins.
Very good.
Meg!
Amy!
Meg, let me look
You're
at
so
you.
You're so beautiful. Marmy!
Your mother now, twins. I can't believe it.
Neither can I.
My baby
is home. You're all grown up.
I am, Marmy. I really am. I feel older. I'm sophisticated. You wouldn't believe all the experiences I've had. And wherever I was, I'd think, if only Joe was here. If only Meg. If only Beth was here, Amy. I'm so sorry I wasn't here to say goodbye to her. I cried for weeks. Aunt March said I was being unreasonable, but my heart was just breaking not to be with her.
Beth understood.
Joe!
She said, tell Amy not to fret.
Did she really say that?
She was so brave. To the very end, you would have been proud of her.
I bought her this metronome. The man said there wasn't another one like it. Where did we get this magnificent piano?
Mr. Lawrence gave it to Beth.
He's a dear, isn't he? It's so amazing to be back here in our dear house.
Amy, come show the rest of us what you got back.
Oh, it's a king's ransom, Barbie. I can't wait to tell you everything. I ate frogs, actual frogs. And how is John? Is he still romantic?
More so.
I knew it. Men are so amazing.
It's almost everything.
Lori? I hadn't realized you'd come back too.
Yes, we were all on the same ship.
You look different.
Do I? I'm taller. Manage yourself.
It was so good of you to comfort Amy and Aunt March after the loss of our Beth.
I was devastated when I heard the news. I should have visited you when I was in New York. No. I thought about it. I should have.
I don't blame you, Lori. I was so unfeeling.
You said what you felt.
No. Guess what? I sold the story.
You did? I always had that sort of faith in you, Joe.
I know you did.
You look different too, you know? Very distinguished.
Really?
Can I tell you something?
What's that?
I've learned something about myself. I was never meant to fly in golden wings.
Who is?
You. You, Joe. You were meant to soar. Me? I'm meant for more mundane things. I've decided to go into grandfather's business. I know it's the last thing I would have thought for myself, but I'm sort of fascinated with the prospects. I shall be wildly insured.
Lori,
thank you. Did you tell Joe?
Tell me what?
The most amazing thing.
Really quite a thing.
You tell her?
No. You should. should tell her.
All right, I'll tell her.
We were under the bridge of sighs.
Gondola.
Under Italian skies.
She was singing lullabies.
He says he likes the way I sing.
We found that we
were so alike.
It was amazing.
I said I love fireflies.
I said so do I.
I told him I hate goodbyes.
There was something in her eyes.
I swear the bells began to ring.
The day was ours.
We talked for hours.
It was amazing.
Who proposed to whom?
You know, we were trying to be so discreet about it.
Amazing, there we were in Venice.
In a gondola.
In Venice.
And we suddenly stood up.
Shouted, will you marry me?
It was so romantic.
And I fell into the water.
And before we even knew it,
she'd dove in and rescued me.
Happened before we knew.
How could you have known?
Amazing what time can do.
From that moment my heart flew.
We'll be married in the spring.
Who'd ever thought in all the world we'd fall in love, and yet we did. Amazing, amazing, the most amazing thing.
Come, Laurie, help me with the rest of my things. And later, Aunt Marsh wants to talk to us about proper wedding etiquette. Laurie, welcome to the family.
Thank you, Joe.
Joe, I never meant for it to happen like this. I had always thought of Lori as yours.
Lori's never been mine. He was always one of us.
Joe, I brought this for you. It's a book of my drawings. All the churches and palaces and mountains, everything that you should have seen. I want you to have
them. Amy, I can't.
Yes, you can, Joe. We'll be close. That will never change.
Never. Amy, these drawings are beautiful. Thank you. Get to it. The attic used to be such sanctuary for you. Whenever you were sad or disappointed, you'd run up here, bolt the door, and come back hours later so full of life. I haven't seen that Joe in a long time. I can't write. I can't do anything, really. You were right. In the past, I could always come up with something. I was always so good at that. Beth would say Joe can make the clouds disappear. I want Beth back. I should have never broken our promise. I should have never gone to New York. Joe,
if I had stayed here, everything would have been different.
Joe, stop it.
No,
No one could have done more for Beth than you did. You could not have changed what happened. How do you do it? How do you go on day in, day out, as if nothing ever happened? You think that's how I go on? You're strong and wise. How can I be like you? How do I have your strength? Don't make so much of me, Joe.
I never dreamed of this sorrow. I never thought I'd have reason to lament. I hoped I'd never know heartbreak. How I wish I could change the way things went. I wanted nothing but goodness. I wanted reason to prevail. Not this bare emptiness. I wanted days of plenty. But I refuse to feel tragic. I am aching for more than pain and grief. There has got to be meaning. Most of all, when a life has been so brief, I have got to know something. How can I give her any less? I want life to go on.
Abandoned in this hour, oh, work out. Christmas without presents, said Amy, with her usual pout. And we haven't got Father to read to us, said Joe, who yearned to travel and write great books. Only Beth, sitting contented, said, in a tone so sweet, even angels would have listened. But we've got each other. Everything I promised them is here. All of us the way we used to be. We will always have each other. We will always be the fire.
This day will be magnificent. Soon, Lori and Amy will be living in wedded bliss.
Meg, look at me. I can't get married looking like this. This dress is not très beau.
Dress is very très beau.
Why did I choose white for the flowers?
Amy, come, let me finish your hair.
I made all the wrong choices for the wedding, Marmee. Flowers, this dress.
You're like a Madonna.
Mercy, John.
all Lori's idea to have our wedding on our petite maison. And I give it I, more than more, nothing.
Why is she speaking French?
Is that crazy at all, that in?
Worse.
John!
You were inspiring!
John, Father's telegram said he's trying to be arriving at noon. You must go meet him at the station.
Three sets of dishes, two sets of silver, 16 chairs, 4 cut glass bowls, and all the flowers from my conservatory. I have joyfully been divested of all my worldly possessions.
You're insane.
Oh.
You're not to see her before the wedding.
I know. Grandfather, here's the champagne you asked for.
I'll take it. I'm off to the train station.
Well, Lori, let's have a cigar before the ceremony begins. How are you feeling? Ready to be a bridegroom?
My life has never been more complete, and the rain has held up.
Where is Josephine?
I'll go find her.
Ah, yes, and tell Amy I wish to talk to her about receiving line etiquette. We have the cream of Concord society arriving at any moment. I understand you wish to speak to me. I suppose you realize this could have been your day. You think I've made a ghastly mistake. I do not. Amy and Lori are ideally suited to each other. I've gone over my will. And March, Meg will inherit most of my money. Amy is making her way into society and won't need any of it. And as for you,
I don't want anything.
I know you don't want anything, but yet you want everything. Josephine, every woman needs something to fall back upon when times are bleak. To you, I've left you my house.
Your house?
Do something worthwhile with it, a school or library.
Aunt March, that's very generous of you. Thank you.
I don't like that dress. It was one of your old ones. Well, I think I wore it better.
Joe, there's a strange man at the front gate asking for you. Professor Bayer!
Hello!
Hello. This is a surprise.
Yes, I know. You wrote if I should ever come north that I should come and visit you.
Yes, but...
Yes, you didn't think I would. Well, I did. I'm here now. Should I go?
No.
I'm not intruding on anything, or...
No. Come inside. I'll introduce you.
Oh, no. Please, no. Miss March. Not yet.
How's Mrs. Kirk?
Oh, she's as impossible as ever.
And the boarders?
As strange as ever.
And you?
Me. I'm the same.
You look...
old. Yes, I know. I'm nearly 50, if I recall.
You're 34.
35.
You had a birthday?
Yes. They threw me a party. I don't like parties. I get sick. In any case, Miss March, it was so good of you to send me your manuscript. It's interesting. A novel?
There's no one whose opinion I respect more than yours. Forgive me for presuming.
Oh, no, Miss March, I enjoyed it very much. It was fantastic. It touched me very deeply. I heard you. I heard your voice. I felt your spirit. It was fantastic.
Joe, Amy is driving me insane. Now she's talking about changing her veil and... Oh, excuse me. This is my sister Meg. This is Professor Bay.
Ah, I recognize you now from your sister's stories.
So you're the one she's let read them. I'll be right there.
I've come at a bad time.
No, it's just a wedding.
Oh, yeah, a wedding.
I often think about you, Professor. I wonder how you are doing.
Well,
I bought a kite.
You bought a kite?
Yes, yes. Soon after you left, I went out to the park and I flew a kite. I've never had a kite before. Miss Marsh.
Joe.
We are not at all alike. We have our differences. May I be blunt?
Be blunt. By all means.
I think perhaps it looks like rain.
The sky gets bluer by the hour.
The water falls in little drops.
That's why it's called a sun shower.
And now it stops.
You were about to be blunt.
If I say rain, then you say sun. If I say yes, then you say no. It seems before we start, we're done. We even argue at hello. If I say share with me this small umbrella.
I say who cares if I get wet?
We are as different as the morning and the night.
No, we're as different as the winter and the spring.
We always seem to fight.
We disagree on everything.
And yet, you make me smile, you make me laugh, you make me care. How can I explain inside my heart I feel pain when you're not there? Though we are not at all alike, you make me feel alive. If we had that in common, that one small thing in common, love could be like a small umbrella in the rain.
Josephine!
Christopher Columbus!
The guests are arriving soon. I want the family gathered in the parlor. And who is this man? This is my Aunt March. This is Professor Bear.
Call me Fritz.
Fritz! Is that your name, Fritz?
Did I not tell you?
No. Very well then. Bring in Fritz. You were saying, Fritz?
Yes. When people discover passion, they've come upon something rare. This fervor they have in common could shelter them anywhere. All the rest may be rough. With such passion to share, I think we have more than enough. Enough to make a marriage if we dare.
You are proposing?
No, yes, yes. I do not mean today or tomorrow or next month or in 2 months, a year, 2 months, 3 years, and perhaps I'm a patient man. This I prefer, this I tore.
I'll speak my mind, you can be sure.
I'll be enchanted to the core.
If I say let me share your small umbrella.
I'll say who cares if we get wet.
We'll be as different as a husband and a wife.
No. We'll be different as a woman and a man.
Fight our way through life.
We'll disagree the best we can.
And yet, you make me smile, you make me laugh, you make me care.
How can I explain inside my heart I feel pain when you're not there?
Oh, we are not at all alike.
love is like a small umbrella in the
news.
What news?
I showed your novel to Henry Dashworth.
You did what?
He's a stubborn man. He's a stubborn man, I know. He's blunt and he's arrogant to a fault. And,
what did he say?
He said he liked it. He said it was a bit long and he missed the blood and guts stuff. But he liked the idea of the four sisters, especially the outspoken one. And he wants to publish it.
You said that?
If you'll let him.
Joe? We need you inside. Marmy, I have someone I want you to meet. This is Professor Fritz Bayer. He's going to be staying with us for a while. We're thinking of starting a school together.
A school?
Not today, or next week, but someday. Welcome, Professor. Come and meet our family. Sometimes when you dream, your dreams come true in extraordinary ways. Suddenly a day can be so amazing. And sometimes when you're young, you burn the air. And then you are not the same. And the world.
Joe, we're all waiting.
Just want to take a minute to honor the seniors that are here tonight. So seniors of the cast and crew and the pit, can you come up on stage? Come up for
Thank you.